Welcome to Camp Constitution Radio with your host, Hal Shurtleff. Camp Constitution Radio is heard on WBCQ The Planet shortwave every Monday night at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, coming out of the beautiful Monticello, Maine, up in Arista County. And before we bring on our guest, just like to talk a little bit about what Camp Constitution has to offer. In addition to this radio show, which is heard here Monday, and we also hope to get a few more outlets for this show, is also available on the Camp Constitution YouTube channel, as we able to upload them. We run a family camp, a week and a day long family camp in Ringe, New Hampshire, which is in the southwest corner of the state. This year's camp runs from July 12th to the 19th. And for more information, you can visit our website, campconstitution.net. Also, we have an online bookstore with some of the unique things that we have published, as well as some important reprints. And we have a great lineup of instructors at this year's camp, including Tom DeWeese of American Policy Center, Mrs. Chris Ann Hall, constitutional attorney, and the gentleman that's on the line here, Mr. Earl Wallace. Earl Wallace has been an instructor, I think, for the last 4 or 5 years at camp. A very popular, very talented guy. And not only is he does a great job instructing in a number of classes, but he's a talented guitar player and musician. He's the author of The Three-Dimensional Leader, Negotiating Your Mission, Resources, and Content. Good evening, Earl.
Good evening, Hal. How are you?
Good. Well, I know you've been away a lot. You've been in the Middle East. I saw a picture of you, I think it was on your Facebook page, of you sitting down with some folks and was a guitar or one of the countries on the Saudi Arabia Peninsula.
It was Dubai, actually.
Dubai. Wow, that's quite impressive. Well, tell us a little bit about the book. And I read this book. You gave it to me a few years ago. And there are so many leadership-type books out there. And, you know, a lot of times people read them because they have to, or they read them and they put them down. And I think I saw a statistic where how much money is spent on these types of books, and only a small fraction of the people that read these things actually employ or use any of the information. But tell us about, first of all, tell us what motivated you to write this book and the success you're having with this, I would call it a ministry more than a profession, but it's a ministry.
Well, it's sort of a tent-making ministry because I actually do provide workshops, seminars, weekend retreats to churches, which originally was my focus for the book. However, the book, as it turned out and evolved over several years before I actually published it, it became a business book because when I was a high school English teacher, I saw my class as a team, and I taught them how to work together as a team. I'd been in the military and I had some military training, and I'd been a drill instructor in the military, and I was focused on how do you get large groups of people to buy into a common mission and achieve something together. So my classes, I taught English for 2 years, and the first year we had 92.4%, I think it was, of my students pass the Regents exam.
And this is in New York State. This is New York State, you say?
Yep, that was at Saratoga Springs Senior High School. And the second year we had, I think, 94.6, so it was like 95. Now, in my school, and the statewide averages as well, were about 50% passage rate. And so one would think that with that type of success that my department head would have embraced me, but she really didn't. She said that they were in the habit of giving education majors tenure. They're not in the habit of giving writers tenure. So I kind of saw the writing on the wall there. And a couple of years before I began teaching high school English, while I was in college, a female veteran walked up to me after a church service with her little prayer group. And she said, "I know you think I'm crazy, but God told us at our Wednesday night prayer meeting, Mr. Earl Wallace, that you are going to handle my case with the VA. Well, I get this overwhelming sense to go do something else while I am teaching high school English. I take a state exam, and I end up at the State Division of Veterans Affairs. That lady calls a couple of months after I got the job, I think about 4 months after I was on the job, looking for an older man who was training me. And he said, you know, she calls a couple times a year, her case is going to go, it goes back to the 50s. No one's ever going to straighten it out. Just don't even get involved in it. But she kept calling, and I felt guilty that we were blowing this lady off. So I just talked to her a little bit, and we discovered who we each were. And she said, "Didn't I tell you God said you're going to handle this?" Mm-hmm. And I tried to convince her, "Look, I don't know what I'm doing." But she insisted and came down with her, one of her friends who was at church that Sunday, who had stood with her and told me, "God told you you're going to do this." And that was about 7 years from the date that they spoke to me the first time, or some people would say the date of that first prophecy. And we filed a case, and it wound its way through the VA system. And 7 years later, she won the largest retroactive settlement from the Veterans Administration in New York State history. May have been the largest case in the nation's history, but I don't really have any way to verify that. Uh-huh. But some people told me it was. And she got her first check went retroactive. She got it in 1994, I think in the fall of 1994, and it went back to 1954.
So oh, my goodness.
She got a check to stand 40 years of benefit.
Wow.
And ongoing entitlements. But in the meantime, my office was outperforming most, if not all, the offices. Over a four-year period of time, I think 3 years, we outperformed all the other offices in New York State. In terms of the number of claims we filed, the number of claims we won, I call them exotic cases, the number of exotic cases we won. In the meantime, my secretary, of course, I was getting overwhelmed with paperwork. I was having calls. People were calling me from Georgia. My American Legion county chair went on vacation to Georgia one day, and he calls me at my home on a Saturday morning, and he insisted I talk to a woman there, his friend's mother, who was a widow and having trouble with her VA case. And it just got to be too much. And so my secretary was a very gifted, talented person, and I discovered that she had some hidden talents. And if you go to my website, www.3dimensionalleader.com or 3dmrc.com, you will see a blog called Secretary Supersedes the Status Quo. And it tells the story of how my secretary solved some challenges in my office, and I convinced her to take those responsibilities on, though they were out of job title for her. And about a year or two later, the state did a productivity study wondering how my office was accomplishing so much, and they discovered that I'm using my secretary in a different way. To make a long story short, we were able to develop a job title based upon how my secretary worked. And to this day at the State Division of Veterans Affairs in New York State, there are 7 to 9 people who are called program aides. And my secretary and I invented that job title. And so we were doing a number of things that were innovative, cutting edge. And I began documenting how we were accomplishing these things. And also I got to organize a couple of statewide training programs for the agency. And so it forced me to sit down and understand how we were accomplishing what we were accomplishing. How was I training my secretary to train other people who would come into our office to work? And then I took over. I started praying. I said, "God, these things are really working. These concepts, I would like to try them over a larger organization." And I was able to take over a statewide organization. And that had not really done what it was supposed to do in probably 15, 20 years. I say 35 years, which is probably more accurate because they were playing around with numbers a lot, mm-hmm. trying to make excuses why the performance wasn't the way it should be. But I believe that if you, my book talks about, the three-dimensional leader says that people provide potential. And if you train them right and get them to think appropriately, and we taught them some concepts and how to get along better with each other in their offices, and we strengthened those office teams. And within 6 months, we hit our performance standards for the first time. In memorable history, at least in 5 years. And then by my fifth quarter there, we were exceeding our standards in every customer segment category by between 6% and 24%.
Wow.
So now, I wrote this book, and I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to mention that you use Old Testament people to for your three dimensions, the one-dimensional leader, the two. So can you discuss that? I thought that was very fascinating. How certain Old Testament people and how you use them as go ahead and roll with it. Explain how you did that.
Well, you are correct. I do use Old Testament judges primarily as the models for the types of leadership in my book. How that evolved, it's going to sound very religious here, but I was supervising for the State Division of Veterans Affairs.
We don't mind sounding too religious on this show.
That's good. This is NPR. We co-mingle at Camp Constitution because, you know, Hal, Christianity is my Christianity is a religion. Christianity
right.
is a culture. And
right,
I live
exactly.
my culture no matter where I am. I live my culture in Dubai. So now I was at one point I began supervising 11, 14 offices between Hudson, New York and Messina, New York. And as I was traveling around to all those small towns, I began seeing churches close. And I said, God, why are churches closing? And that went on for about, I'd say 11 months. And one day I was going to a small town. I was quite alarmed because I saw a Baptist church had closed up. And there was a Hindi temple or something in its place. And I said, God, what is going on with your churches? And the Lord had been saying to me off and on, it's leadership, Earl, it's leadership. Leadership is you know, our challenge is, as Christians is to be like what Second Chronicles calls the men of Issachar. The men of Issachar were about the smallest number of a group of people that gathered under King David. And they were, the Bible says the men of Issachar were wise. They knew the times and they knew what Israel should do. And so I was thinking about that and praying about, you know, and the Lord says leadership. So one day I said to the Lord, you keep saying leadership. What do you mean? And he said, go home and read the book of Judges, and I will begin to show you what I'm talking about. And so in the book of Judges, I noticed that there are leaders like Samson who have a lot of personal gifts, but they're focused on themselves. They're one-dimensional leaders. One-dimensional leadership is all about me, not the mission. And Samson has all these incredible gifts that God gave him. The Holy Spirit says that Samson was a judge, but there's nothing in Samson's behavior or character, or his verbiage, anything coming out of his mouth, nothing in his frame of reference that lets us know that he knows what he's supposed to be doing with those gifts. He just uses them to chase girls.
Hmm.
So, then there are other leaders in the book of
Daniel. And by the way, there are a lot of pastors in churches that do similar things. And I've been involved. I was involved in one some years ago, but it was a real shame because it was growing and making an impact in the community. And then bingo, a sex scandal broke out and really caused trouble. And that happens all the time.
It's unfortunate.
And a lot of these churches have enablers. There are people, elders around the pastor that sort of, well, we kind of look the other way and enable people to do what they do. And that's a big, there are a lot of people, like Nathan the prophet that went to David and said, you know, somebody had taken, one person had one sheep, and this big sheep owner took that one sheep from the person who had many, and King David said, who is that? I want to bring him here, so I'll punish him. And he said, it is you, my king. You know, so there are a lot of people that have the courage to confront this, and not only in churches, but in politics and in our culture in general.
Well, you know, the here's one of the challenges is one-dimensional leaders will surround themselves with one-dimensional followers. My book literally says this. Womanizers hire womanizers. Homosexuals hire homosexuals.
Mm, that's right.
I was on a job interview once, and the boss said to me, the guy interviewing me, he says, isn't my secretary hot?
Wow.
And I just said, I'm sorry, sir. I'm not noticing those types of things, and I don't do that on the workplace.
Mm.
And he was sizing me up. He wanted to know, am I going to be the kind of guy that he can hang around with and do what he wants to do? And the answer was no. So I knew by the end of the interview, I'm not getting this job. He said a couple other things that were indications to me. This guy wants to, you know, he wants to use his position and to do certain things, and I'm just not going to do them with him. And
right.
I let him know right up front. I also was on a job I actually was on a job interview. No, I take that back. I got hired, and my first meeting with a director. The director told me about having an affair. So, well, it was a time when I was separated from my spouse. This happened to be a female telling me this, too.
Really?
I was separated from my husband. And she told me whose girlfriend she was, and she was the girlfriend of a prominent politician. That's how she probably got a job. It was probably a power thing. But I just blurted out, but just spontaneously, I said, ma'am, I don't go for this boy, girl, he said, she said, kiss and tell stuff
mm-hmm.
in the workplace. It has no place in my frame of reference. I don't even want to know about it.
That's good.
And I blurted it out so quickly, I almost put my hands over my mouth and thought, oh my gosh, this is my boss, you idiot. You're going to get furious. You're going to get blacklisted before you have a chance to even make an impact. So, yeah, you're right. The one-dimensional leaders use their position to get what they want to do from the system. One-dimensional leaders and one-dimensional employees, they leverage relationships to get what they want from organizations.
You are listening to, I just want to give a little intro here, halfway through the show. You're listening to Camp Constitution Radio on WBCQ The Planet, campconstitution.net. For those of you who like more information about our not only our program, but our wonderful week-long family camp that takes place this year from July 12th to the 19th in the Towanippe Christian Retreat Center in Ridge, New Hampshire. That's campconstitution.net. Go ahead, Earl. Sorry.
No, that's great. It's important for people to know about this camp because if you have a high school student or a younger out there and you see our country going off the rails, it's because our students are no longer learning in public school anyway. They're not learning what our Constitution is about. And I hope, Hal, we get a chance today, but I want to talk about something that I've discovered, I think, which is the foundation of why our churches are not effective culturally. But we'll talk about that later. Back to leadership. Two-dimensional leaders needlessly set up us versus them dynamics. They, instead of saying, hey, we're all in this together and let's all stay focused on the mission, two-dimensional leaders have character and personality flaws. So they too are focused on what's in it for me. And consequently, they always set up me versus you dynamics, us versus them dynamics. And they fracture teams. This us versus them dynamic, this me versus you dynamic, is really how silos form within organizations. I've been in meetings with commissioners and other people. I work in government, and I would say to them, you know, we need to stop whispering about these things. If we're whispering about this particular topic, we're talking about something that we shouldn't even be talking about as public officials, because we're public. We should not be in a position where we're going to have to hide things from the public.
Right.
And so you needlessly set up these, and look at what's going on in our country. We have, instead of having the representative three branches of government that we have, or the three divisions of government, we have a Congress that will not hold the president accountable to his constitutional obligations. We have a Supreme Court that no longer looks at laws passed by the Congress or executive orders foisted on us by a president. They don't look at those under the light of the Constitution. Instead, the Supreme Court's just saying, well, I wonder how we can make this, how can we wrangle terminology to make whatever the government does legal? And here's one of the things I want to teach this year at Camp Constitution. You know, our Constitution has enumerated powers. It lists the powers. It lists the things that government can and cannot do. Whenever government varies or does something that's not on that list, that's when they're violating our rights.
And that's quite often. I mean, a number of constitutional scholars have said, and you don't have to be a scholar to observe this, but about 80% of what the federal government does is unconstitutional, and probably that same percentage at the state level, too. And how many people we know that live in towns and cities, and they'll say, gee, my town is the most corrupt town, and no matter where I go. And the sad thing is, I was quoting President James Garfield, and I was actually looking for the quote here, but he said, to paraphrase, he said, if our Congress is corrupt, it's because the people accept corruption. If our Congress is honorable, it's because the people want honorable people representing them. So all these smoke and mirror plans to save our Constitution by adding a bunch of amendments, what have you, won't change. If people want corruption, they're going to get it. And right now, unfortunately, a disproportionate number of the population, over 51%, seems to like big government. They seem to like members of Congress doing the wrong thing because they're somehow benefiting. In other words, well, gee, I don't really like this issue, but if I'm voting for my guy or my lady because they're giving me the goodies too, you know. And that seemed to be the problem. We have very few three-dimensional leaders. Why don't you explain what exactly is a three-dimensional leader?
Well, in the book of Judges, there are several three-dimensional leaders, but I like to use Deborah for because a three-dimensional leader understands his or her role and really tries to empower other people to fulfill their role. And the reason I focus on Deborah in my three-dimensional leadership book, which is a business book, but it does have this chapter three, this template from the book of Judges, which we expand upon throughout the book. And what happens is a three-dimensional leader is supposed to know what the mission that matters most. And in the Old Testament Israel, it was, we've got to secure our land. We've got to have peace in our land. We have to, otherwise people can't shop. They can't go to work. You can't actuate your life if you're worried about terrorists blowing up your marketplace and your office and your business sectors. So Deborah understands this. She is not a warrior, but she understands resources. Remember, the book is subtitled Mission, Resources, and Context. Barat, she knows that I need a resource called the military. So she calls a gentleman named Barak, who God has spoken to her and said, this man is going to be the general. And Barat, and I'm sorry, what's his name? Deborah and Book of Judges, chapter 5. What's that guy's name?
That's all right.
And so he is going to be the general. And he says, I'm not going to go unless you go with me. And I've heard a lot of people, you know, denigrate that guy. And I thought, no, you know, he, Barak is his name, Barak. And if you told me that God told you that I'm supposed to go punch somebody in the nose and you're not going to come with me, what would my confidence be that God really told you? So Deborah says, that's fine. I'll come with you. Deborah knows that there's more than one way to accomplish something. She does not needlessly lock herself into either or thinking, either or dynamic, me versus you dynamic. She says, okay, we'll do it your way. And I teach in my leadership programs, your people probably have a lot of good ideas, especially once you've acclimated them and trained them to the mission that matters most, and you give them some of these other abilities that are listed in my book and explained in the book, how you get people to think as team members, how you get people to understand that they're about 80%. Once we all have the same value system and the same motivations, we're each going to probably get about 80% of what we want, because we approach the same challenge from our own varying, from different perspectives. So the book talks about how do you get synergy from the diversity of personality types and psychological perspectives that the Lord is bringing to your table, bringing to your team. And synergy means that the output is greater than the sum of the individual parts. One-dimensional leaders will never let you do what they don't know. Two-dimensional leaders, well, they understand mission and they understand resources to a degree, but they don't understand context. So there's always a big picture of view of things that they're missing. Consequently, they may only let an organization move into two-thirds of the things that it really should be engaged in, because they won't fully trust their people, because they have this huge blind spot called they can't see the larger context in which the business or the operation is unfolding within. They don't see the operation within its context. They don't understand how partners operate. They don't understand how the community may choose to access the resources, where your store is located. Two dimensionals have a number. They have a big blind spot called context, but it affects a lot of things. So anyway,
I think you summed it up by saying the team is first and foremost, not the mission, but the second two-dimensional leader.
Yes. That's right. Two-dimensionals, they do things based upon who they know, not necessarily what those people know. Three-dimensional leaders, I'm focused on what you need to know to do your job. And I used to have people call me up and they would say, Mr. Wallace, I want to be on your team. I'll be loyal to you. I said, being loyal to me is okay. I'm like backstabbers, but being loyal to me is not a mission.
Right.
Our mission is the mission. Well, the reason our organization exists is our mission. The reason we've been hired is the mission. I may stray from that, and I need people around me who will not be yes people, but will
you need no men as well as you need no men when you get off and that happens to the best of people.
Absolutely, we are all woefully human, and that's our challenge.
That's right. So, I mean, it's yes men are usually your worst enemy, because you might come out with a decision that could be very destructive to your mission, to your company, and you want no men around. I mean, I see that in different organizations, you know, come on, this is not a good idea. And let's talk. Let's. Oh no, no, no. This is what the boss says. We got to go for it. You know, you want to agree with the boss because the boss is the one that dispenses the pay raises and all of the benefits go along with agreeing with the boss. But sometimes when you look back about it, they say thank you for, you know, for your advice, because with that we would be in big trouble. Hey Earl, we have only a few minutes left here. We got about 5 minutes left. So you were discussing something you had in mind at camp this year. Now, Earl has been an instructor at our camp, and he's a very popular instructor. He gives a very dynamic present. One of them is what the biblical basis for the Bill of Rights, and then the dynamic decalogue for decency. How does that go?
Okay, well, the first, there are four presentations,
yeah.
Which are going to be four parts of a book. Hal, I told someone last week I wasn't going to do any more radio shows until I got this book written. I told someone a couple days ago, I said, I may not even teach at Camp Constitution if I don't get this book written. And I told someone this morning, well, I'm doing a radio program for Camp Constitution, so I guess I'm coming up better get this book done or not. So, but the first part of this, of my focus or my program is called the Divine Decalogue for Dynamic Decency. Divine, it comes from God. A decalogue is a compilation of 10. It's the 10 commandments. And I put the 10 commandments in positive paraphrases. I believe God gave them to me that way because people don't want to really relate to the thou shalt not. But if we explain the 10 commandments in positive paraphrases, such as commandment number 6, thou shalt not murder, really is mercy mitigates murder. Mm-hmm. Commandment number 7, about sexual purity, really is if you date right, you mate right.
Your mate's
going to be wrong. Commandment number 8, you're not stealing, you're ripping both yourself and the other person out of God's plan for both your material blessings. So we take these 10 commandments, and then we move into something called the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights. Once you understand the positive values, the positive outcomes of the 10 commandments in terms of societal living, I explain how that was the founding fathers' value system with which they codified in the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights are the enumerated powers that that our founding fathers said, government, thou shalt not do these things. The Bill of Rights
That's
could have
right.
been named the 10 commandments of government.
Oh, the thou shalt nots of government, because it really restricted what Congress couldn't do. It didn't say, people talk about, I have a First Amendment right or this and they said, no, you have a right protected by the First Amendment, but the right comes from God, not from government.
Absolutely. And so if we think of the 10 commandments along those same lines, God enumerated our rights in the 10 commandments. You have a right not to be murdered. You have a right not to be stolen from. You have the right not to have the sanctity of your family violated. Like, you have the right not to be stolen from. So when the government says, I'm going
to the right to own property.
Yes. Actually, if we think about it this way, the rights, the natural rights that God gives us in the 10 commandments, they are summed up, and you have the right to pursue life, liberty, and happiness, and property. And I'm going to teach it that way at camp this summer. Put a little different spin on how I've been sharing it with people. Now,
hey, Earl, we got one minute left, so we got to wrap it up. How can people get a hold of your book, get a hold of you, if they want to have you give a presentation?
Well, if you go to www.3.com, you have to write out the word 3dimensionalleader.com or 3dmrc.com. And you can reach me on my website. The book is available on Amazon.com, or you can go to Tate Publishing and Enterprises. You also can buy it off my website. I would appreciate that. And I do business consulting. We do leadership and organizational training, as you know, around the world. I'm very focused on the church, because the church is the foundation of the liberties in America, not the church itself, but the Bible is. So the founding fathers
right.
wanted people to go to church, because that's where you learn about the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights.
That's right. Well, we thank you for having you on, Earl. This is Hal Shurtleff with Camp Constitution Radio on WBCQ The Planet. Thank you for listening. Until next time, God bless.
Thank you, Hal.